Today's topic is gas cycle refrigeration. First of all, let us discuss about the limitations of the Carnot cycle with gas as a refrigerant. Although the Carnot cycle is the most efficient cycle between fixed temperature limits and is useful as a criteria of perfection, it has inherent drawbacks when gas is used as a refrigerant, as can be seen from the PV diagram. Now, this shows the PV diagram. The process 1 to 2 is the reversible adiabatic compression. This is the process 1 to 2. From 2 to 3, it is the heat rejection at constant temperature TK, which is the high temperature in the cycle. 3 to 4 is reversible adiabatic expansion, and 4 to 1 is the heat addition to the cycle actually. So during this process, there is heat transfer Q4 to 1, and during this process there is heat rejection Q2 to 3, and during the other two processes, that is 1 to 2, the value of heat transfer is 0, and here also for this particular process the value of heat transfer is 0. Extreme pressures and large volumes are developed since the pressure rise takes place both during isentropic compression as well as isothermal heat rejection processes. So you can see the point number 1 to 2, it is the reversible adiabatic compression, and here the pressure is increasing from P1 to P2. Similarly, if we see the isothermal process of heat rejection 2 to 3, during this process also there is increase in pressure from P2 to P3. So basically both during constant temperature process as well as reversible adiabatic compression process, the pressure is going to increase from P1 to P2 and from P2 to P3. The next is isothermal heat transfer process with gas with a medium with a finite specific heat are impossible to achieve in practice. Actually, what happens when we talk about the reversed Carnot cycle, we say that there is no difference of temperature between the source and the system. When there is no temperature difference, how the heat will be transferred? Now, we know from the formula of heat transfer that Q is equal to Cp into delta T. So, if the value of delta T is very, very small, if I consider, then the value of Cp should be very, very large. And that is not the case with a gas actually. So this is the reason that we cannot use gas as a refrigerant in a reverse Carnot cycle. Now next thing is, if you see the PV diagram, there can be large irreversibilities during these processes. We are considering them to be reversible processes, but in actual practice, if we will consider them in actual case, there will be irreversibilities. And even if there are very small irreversibilities in the individual processes, it may cause a significant increase in the work required during the system. So that means any irreversibility in the process will cause the work transfer or the work required in the system to increase a lot. Okay, so that is the reason that we cannot use a reversed Carnot cycle in a refrigeration system with gas as a refrigerant. So rather than the reversed Carnot cycle, we go for a reverse Brayton or Joule or Bell-Coleman cycle with gas as a refrigerant. In a reversed Brayton or Joule or Bell-Coleman cycle, the two isothermal processes 2-3 and 4-1, that means 2-3 is this process and 4-1 is this process. So if you will see, this is a reversed Carnot cycle taking place from 4-1, 1-2, and 2-3 and 3-4. These are replaced, which process is 2-3 and 4-1. 2-3 is the constant temperature process and 4-1 is also the constant temperature process. These are replaced by two more practical processes, and these two more practical processes are actually isobaric processes, that is process 2 to 3 and process 4 to 1 respectively, as shown on the TS diagram. So you can see it here, this is the 2 to 3 process and this is the 4 to 1 process, this process and this process. So these are two reversible isobaric processes, or for simplicity we can also call them as the isobaric processes. So that means we have replaced the isothermal processes by two isobaric processes. Now let us focus on this diagram once again so that we can understand by doing so what has actually happened. Now if you see this diagram for the reversed Connaught cycle, that is starting from point 1, 2 dash, 3 and 4 dash. This is the cycle. And if we see the area under the curve, this total area is the refrigerating effect in case of a reversed Connaught cycle actually. Now when we replace the process 1 to 4 dash, that means this process, by the process 4 dash to 1, then this area is actually converted into work required, and we are left with only this much amount of the cooling effect, this much amount, the area under the line 4 to 1. So we say there is loss of refrigerating effect due to changing the process from isothermal to isobaric process. Similarly, on the upper side also, in the process 2 to 3, this is actually 2 dash to 3 is replaced by process 2 to 3. This is the process. Now, when we replace this process by this particular process, then what will happen? There is this area which has been added to the system. This area has been added to the cycle, and this also increases the work. So you can see here it is written by plus delta WK, and it is written as plus delta W naught. Delta W naught means this is the work which is increased at the lower temperature, and delta WK is the work which is increased at the higher temperature. And this plus delta W naught is also showing there is loss of the refrigerating effect. So I think this part is clear to you. This is what we have shown here. The same thing which has been explained, I have explained it earlier also. Now this diagram is the schematic diagram of a simple gas cycle. If you see here, there are four components which are shown here. The first component you can see is the refrigerator. The second component is the compressor. The third component is the air cooler. Rather than air cooler, you can also call it as a gas cooler. And then the fourth component is the expander. And towards the refrigerator, it is the low pressure side, and on the air cooler side, it is the high pressure side. And you can see there is a particular mass flow rate of the refrigerant M which is circulating through this system. Now let us see how the system is functioning in this particular case. In this arrangement, the compressor and expander are shown coupled together, since the expander work is utilized to provide a part of the compressor work. So let us focus it here. This is the expander. So the expander is giving us certain amount of the work, let us say WE, whereas in the compressor we have to supply certain work, WC. And you can see this dotted line which is shown here, this is the common shaft of both the expander as well as the compressor. So what happens, we supply the work which is produced in the expander to the compressor. This way we can reduce the net power required for compressing the refrigerant, which is a gas in this particular case. Now let us start from the point number 4. Point number 4 represents the state of the refrigerated air, which would absorb heat at a constant pressure P naught until it attains the temperature corresponding to point 1. So basically what it means to say here is that the pressure here is P naught, and when we say point number 4, the state of the refrigerated air. So we have considered that when we are using a gas, the gas which is being used as a refrigerant is air actually. So in gas cycles actually, mostly air is used as the refrigerant. So we have started from this particular point, which is 4, and the temperature here is T4, whereas the pressure is P0. P0 is, you can say, low temperature, low pressure rather, and in the refrigerator it is causing the cooling, and here we are getting certain amount of the cooling effect Q0. After the heat is added to air, its temperature increases to T1 at the exit of the refrigerator. Now, there is one important point to tell you. In case of the vapor compression cycle, the process 4:1 takes place in an evaporator, where the heat transfer takes place at the constant temperature, because we are adding the latent heat in that particular case, whereas in this case we are adding the sensible heat to the air, because air is a gas, so gas is not going to change its phase. At 1, the air is isentropically compressed to 2 from pressure P0 to pressure Pk. So in the compressor, the air is compressed isentropically from state point 1 to state point 2. So during this process, temperature T1 increases to temperature T2. Here you can see the TS diagram also. The TS diagram shows us process 1:2. This is the process 1:2, which is reversible adiabatic compression, and we have to supply certain amount of the work WC. And during this process, the pressure is increasing from P0 to Pk. You can see the initial temperature here is T1 and the final temperature here is T2. So the temperature has increased and the pressure has also increased in the compression. Then this air is being passed through the air cooler actually. So when it is passed through the air cooler, it is cooled by the surrounding air only, because you know, after the compression, temperature T2 will be higher than the surrounding air temperature. So we are circulating here air only. This is an air cooler. We are cooling the air with the help of the surrounding air. Okay. So surrounding air is used to cool the air which is entering into the air cooler. And this process takes place at constant pressure. So it means during process 2:3, the pressure Pk will remain constant and heat will be rejected to the surrounding. So you can see Qk amount of the heat is rejected to the surrounding, and during this process the pressure is Pk only. At state point 3, the air is sent into the expander. Now after it is sent into the expander, its temperature is reduced from T3 to T4. So you can see it here, the temperature has reduced to T4, and it is a reversible adiabatic expansion. Once again, it is the same diagram. I will tell you once again, process 1:2 is reversible adiabatic compression, process 2:3 is heat rejection in the air cooler, 3:4 is reversible adiabatic expansion in the expander, and 4:1 is the heat transfer in the refrigerator. So this completes the cycle, and now let us proceed to the next slide. Now what we will do, we are going to the analysis of the gas cycle. Now once again, the same TS diagram is shown here. Now there are two processes which are reversible adiabatic compression and expansion. So basically two reversible adiabatic processes are there, and these two reversible adiabatic processes are 1:2 and 3 to 4. This process and this process, the vertical line shows the reversible adiabatic processes. And during this process, we know a relationship between temperature and pressure, and this relationship is given by T2 by T1. This is the ratio of the temperature, which will be equal to Pk by P0 raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma. This is for the process 1 to 2. And if you will take the process 3 to 4, then T3 by T4 will be equal to Pk by P0 raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma. So this equation I am writing first of all, or explaining first of all, because further we will be using this equation. And this Pk by P0 is nothing but it is the pressure ratio in the cycle, which we can represent by the value Rp. Rp means pressure ratio raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma. Now, if we focus on the process 4 to 1, the process 4 to 1 is taking place in the refrigerator. And during this process, the refrigerating effect is given by Q0, and it is equal to Cp into T1 minus T4. So this is the cooling effect produced in the cycle. Now we can calculate the value of the heat rejected as well as the compressor work. So first of all, let us see the compressor work. Compressor work Wc is equal to gamma over gamma minus 1 T2 V2 minus P1 V1, which is also equal to Cp T2 minus T1. Actually, it is very easy to derive this equation. If you take the compressor as an open system, then we have the equation delta Q minus delta Ws is equal to dh plus dke plus dpe. So if we neglect kinetic energy term and potential energy term, then we are left with delta Q, delta Ws and dh. And it's a compressor. The process is reversible adiabatic. So the value of delta Q will be 0. So that means we can integrate this equation from 1 to 2. And on the right hand side also it is 1 to 2. So I will get Ws with a negative sign from 1 to 2, which is equal to H2 minus H1. And next I can write it as Ws 1 to 2 is equal to minus H2 minus H1. So it means, because there is a negative sign, it shows that work is required to be done on the system. So I can write that Wc is equal to H2 minus H1. This mod sign here only shows that we are considering the positive value of the work of compressor. Now let us look at the process 2 to 3. It is a constant pressure process of heat rejection in the air cooler. And once again, we can apply this steady flow energy equation and we will get this particular expression, which is written here, that it is equal to Cp T2 minus T3. So once again, we are putting the negative sign here because this is the heat transfer which is taking place to the from the system to the surroundings. That is why this will be negative actually. But we are interested in calculating the magnitude. That is why we are putting this in the mods. Now, specific expander work, like we have derived the expression for the specific compressor work. Similarly, we can also calculate the specific expander work, which is here given by Cp T3 minus T4. And this can also be written as H3 minus H4. So now what we have done, we have calculated the heat transfers and the work transfer in the cycle. Now next we can calculate the net work of the cycle, which is given by W here. This is once again the magnitude, and the work required to compress is more than the work which we are getting from the expander. And this will also be equal to Qk minus Q0. And the reason is very simple, because from the first law of thermodynamics, we know that cyclic integral of delta Q is equal to cyclic integral of delta W. And using this equation, we can say that W is equal to Qk minus Q0 also. So this is the value of Qk and this is the value of Q0. And this is the value of the W net or the work which is required. Okay, this is the work required or the net work in the circuit. Now what we can do is we can calculate the value of the coefficient of the performance. Now the coefficient of the performance is given by the value of the cooling effect. This is the value of the cooling effect divided by W compressor minus W expander. So what we have done here is we have not taken CP value here, because CP actually cancels out. So the CP is included here, this cancels out, and then we are left with the term T1 minus T4 divided by T2 minus T3 minus T1 minus T4. And then the value of COP is given by, now what we have done here is we have divided the numerator and denominator part by T1 minus T4. So once we divide by T1 minus T4, here we get 1. Here in this first term of the numerator, we get T2 minus T3 divided by T1 minus T4. And the last term, T1 minus T4 divided by T1 minus T4 becomes 1 actually. And now let us see, this is the final expression for the COP, but I want to express COP as a function of pressure ratio and gamma. Gamma is the ratio of the specific heat for the air. So now you can see here, this is the same expression which I told you, which I will be using later on. So T2 minus T1 is equal to T3 minus T4, which is equal to Pk by P0 raised to power gamma minus 1. And I told you that this particular value is nothing but pressure ratio Rp, which is now gamma minus 1 over gamma also. Okay. So in the next step, what I have done is I have subtracted 1 from both the sides. Okay. And before that, I have also converted this expression or taken this expression as T2 by T3 equal to T1 by T4. And then I have subtracted 1 from both the sides. And then you can see I get T2 minus T3 divided by T3 is equal to T1 minus T4 divided by T4. Now you look this expression carefully, this expression very carefully, it can be written as T2 minus T3 divided by T1 minus T4 equal to T3 by T4. And if you will see here, T3 by T4, you can see that this T3 by T4 is actually equal to Pk by P0 raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma, or Rp raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma. So this is the value which is equal to Rp raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma. So next, if you remember exactly, the expression for COP was actually equal to 1 over, if I remember exactly, then it was T2 minus T3 divided by T1 minus T4 minus 1. And this value, from the previous slide, if you will see, T2 minus T3 divided by T1 minus T4 is equal to Rp raised to our gamma minus 1 over gamma. So here you can see what we have done here. We have written this value as Rp raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma minus 1. So that means the value of COP is now 1 over Rp raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma minus 1. Thus, COP is a function of pressure ratio and gamma. Lower the value of the pressure ratio, higher is the COP. Variation of COP with the pressure ratio is given below. So I hope this point is clear to you. I have said that the lower the value of pressure ratio, higher is the COP. How? The expression for COP is given as COP is equal to 1 divided by Rp raised to power gamma minus 1 over gamma minus 1. So as the pressure ratio, if we take a look at the pressure ratio, if the pressure ratio is 1, then what will happen? If this value is 1, then in that particular case, in the denominator, we will get a zero actually. The expression becomes 1 by 0. Okay. So the value of COP goes to infinity. So for a pressure ratio equal to 1, the COP value is equal to infinity. That means I am saying that Pk is equal to P naught. So effectively there is no cooling effect, and that is why the value of COP is infinity. As we increase the pressure ratio to 2, the COP goes to 4.56. If it is 3, the value of COP is 2.71. If it is 4, the value of COP is 2.05. And then further increasing the pressure ratio actually reduces the value of the COP. And mostly we go for a value of COP which lies somewhere between 2.71 to 4.56. That means we have to keep the cycle, we have to go for a cycle where the pressure ratio is between 2 to 3, so that the value of COP is quite appreciable. It should not go down actually. So that is the reason actually we usually operate the air cycle refrigeration between a pressure ratio of 2:3. It may be noted that the pressure Pk and P naught, and hence the pressure ratio Rp, have limitations on account of the operating temperatures, which T1 is the highest refrigerant temperature and T3 is the lowest ambient temp-